Hello and a very warm welcome to our service of morning prayer. This service is being placed on our YouTube channel on Remembrance Sunday, but being recorded in advance of that day. It's very difficult without further technology and, frankly, without people being with you to record a reverent and appropriate Remembrance Day service solo. We're going to be using the form of service for morning prayer, and this follows the order of service that you've all been circulated. We will, however, be pausing for a minute's silence and also to use two of the prayers that are set for Remembrance Day, where hopefully we can bring our prayers and our sorrows and our hopes for the future to God. If you're watching this in real time, you will hopefully, if you wish, have time to go live to the cenotaph at the end of the service. So let's keep silence before we begin. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. Mindful of our own shortcomings and those of a hurting world, we ask the Holy Spirit to help us examine our hearts and bring to God those things which we need to confess and for which we need his forgiveness. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sins and restore you in his image to the praise and the glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As God's forgiven people, let us declare God's praise together. Let everything be said and done in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through Jesus Christ. Sing psalms and hymns and sacred songs. Let us sing to God with thankful hearts. Open our lips, Lord, and we shall praise your name. And we say the Venite together. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving and be glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have moulded the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be for ever. Amen. Our psalm today is Psalm 16. If we have a Bible in front of us, we can say this together. Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I said to the Lord, "You are my God. Apart from you, I have no good thing. As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones, in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those will increase who run after honour other gods. I will not pour out their libations of blood, or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now Val brings us our first reading.
The reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 10, beginning at verse 11. And every priest stands day by day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us. For after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord, I will put laws in their hearts, and I'll write them on their minds." He also adds, "I'll remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. A call to persevere. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. As he was leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what massive stones, what magnificent buildings." "Do you see all these great buildings?" replied Jesus. "Not one here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, opposite the temple, Peter, James, John and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they're about to be fulfilled?" Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming, 'I am he,' and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumours of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginning of birth pains. You must be on your guard. You will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, do not worry beforehand about what to say. Just say whatever is given you at the time, for it is not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. All people will hate you because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now may I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The psalm we heard earlier on and read together, Psalm 16, is a miktam. It's a name for a particular type of psalm. Nobody really knows the full significance of the word miktam, but when they're Psalms of David, they always seem to accompany or be written or prayed at a time when David was himself in deadly danger. So they're psalms in times of threat, psalms in times of danger. And Psalm 16, as we heard, is no exception. "Keep me safe, Lord. Keep me safe, Lord," is the cry that opens it. And in times of pandemic, in times of immense war and suffering around the world, in times where we are rightly more and more aware of the need to do something to stave off the appalling environmental catastrophe that faces us, there's a sense that God's world and ourselves as part of it need God's safety and protection and guidance and wisdom. "Keep me safe." And then there's a sense of a change of direction after that opening pair of verses. The psalmist recalls in the depths of despair, the depths of a feeling of need, a feeling of reassurance and a need for safety. There's a sense that the psalmist becomes aware that he has clung on. Perhaps by the skin of his teeth, as the authorised version would have it. He's clung on by the skin of his teeth. He has followed God. He has walked in the way of God, even in this time of peril. He hasn't given in to the blandishments of the society around him. He hasn't given in to the demands of other religions that crowd around him. He has kept the faith with God, perhaps both those journeys are what has caused him to be in the danger that he's in. Perhaps sometimes our journeys of faith, our journeys of conscience, our journeys of trying to do, say, and work for the right thing have or may or are placing us in danger. Keep me safe, O God. And then for the psalmist, stated to be David, there's another sense of pause within the passage of the psalm. There's another sense, there's a gap in his thought, and he picks it up again. He's somehow been given the blessing of reassurance from God, which we all need a lot of the time. Let's be honest with ourselves. And he realizes that actually God has given him so much. He realizes that he's coming to a place of deep gratitude despite it all. Gratitude to God is a good place to get to in prayer. We can't force ourselves to get there. We have to be led to a place of gratitude. And the psalmist here was led to a place of gratitude. And he says, surely my boundary marker has fallen in pleasant places. Boundary marker, of course, is an incredibly emotive idea now. His neighbour's infringed my boundary. I'm going to cut his tree down. You've seen tragic cases of people who've murdered their neighbours because of disputes over boundaries. And disputes over boundaries have, let's be honest, been some of the main causes of the horrific wars over the last few hundred years. But David isn't talking about that sort of boundary. He's not talking about his house out of Good Housekeeping magazine or one of those property programs that festoon the media, where people just find their dream home. He's not talking about, I've got a lovely house, I've got a lovely garden. He's talking about his boundary with God. Which side of the boundary is he? And which side is he grateful for being on? He's saying the boundary marker is over there. I'm in danger. It hurts. I'm suffering. But the boundary marker's over there. It's fallen over there. And I'm somehow included in the huge loving purposes of God, even in my fear. And that's a good place to be, even when the goosebumps are coming and the beads of sweat and the night terrors are upon him. I know that somehow I am in the boundary of the love of God, and may God grant us all the grace and the gratitude in God's time to understand that that is where we sit and where we stand, whatever the danger, within the boundary marker of the God who keeps us gently at his right hand and holds out his presence forevermore. In the passage in Mark's Gospel, the disciples were looking for some sort of consolation with the impending loss of their Messiah. All these things will be pulled down, says Jesus. And he goes through a grim list of things that we could perhaps relate to the contemporary world. Wars, famines. And yet he says, in all this, I am with you. Watch out. Work. But do not be afraid. I will give you what I need to give you at the right time. Because what God needs to give us and has, praise him, given us, is the boundary marker, the glory side of our lives, the boundary marker, within whose amazing space we are privileged to sit. The cross of Christ carries the hurt of the world. The love of God is capable of more than we can ever hope or ask for. This time of remembrance, we remember untold suffering and loss and pain that is still felt. May God grant us the grace to see his presence in our fear and in our hopes. May we know that God holds us. We say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And I believe he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So we move to a time of remembrance, this Remembrance Sunday. Let us remember before God and commend to his safekeeping those who have died for their country in war, those whom we knew and whose memory we treasure, and all who have lived and died in the service of the peoples of the world. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives." We keep silence. O God of truth and justice, we hold before you those whose memory we cherish, and those whose names we will never know. Help us to lift our eyes above the torment of this broken world, and grant us the grace to pray for those who wish us harm. As we honour the past, may we put our faith in your future. For you are the source of life and hope, now and forever. Amen. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now Alison will lead us in our prayers of intercession.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. We pray for the leaders of the nations, that you will guide them in the ways of freedom, justice, and truth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who bear arms on behalf of the nation, that they may have discipline and discernment, courage and compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our enemies and those who wish us harm, that you will turn the hearts of all to kindness and friendship. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the wounded and the captive, the grieving and the homeless, that in all their trials they may know your love and support. We pray for those who are currently ill or especially needing our prayers at this time. Judith Drazen, Julie Gillen, Diane Randall, Viv Robinson, Claire Ross, Eric Bevan, Mavis John, Albert Page, and Rosemary Penketh. We also pray for those whose anniversary of death occur in the forthcoming week: Kathleen Taylor, Christopher Parks, Enid Joy, Nigel Walton, Emily Powell, Herbert Taylor, John Sanders, Edith Ford, June Webb, and Hazel Nicholson. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Most holy God and Father, hear our prayers for all who strive for peace and all who fight for justice. Help us, who today remember the cost of war, to work for a better tomorrow, and as we commend to you lives lost in terror and conflict, bring us all in the end to the peace of your presence. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We say the collect for today. Almighty Father, whose will is to restore all things in your beloved Son, the King of all, govern the hearts and minds of those in authority, and bring the families of the nations, divided and torn apart by the ravages of sin, to be subject to his just and gentle rule, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the Church, the Queen, the Commonwealth, and all people, unity, peace, and concord, and to us and all God's servants, life everlasting, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.